studies, you all, for being here. Gender and sexuality studies, as it's now called here. Also, my colleague Chris Peterson, with whom we're now, with whom I can talk and exchange ideas while I'm here. It's such a great pleasure. So, thank you for having me back. This is a new project that I've been working on for some time. And it's a project that tries to look at a hitherto relatively unstudied body of texts, which are memoirs, popular memoirs written by former civil servants in India. And I was interested in them because, one, there's a huge trove of these memoirs, and historians look at them to figure out see them as a kind of archive of information about certain periods of Indian history, right? And that's a very important way in which we can look at the memoirs. And many, many politicians, as you know, write them here as well, and all kinds of public figures write them. So it's a really important and interesting genre. And we can look at them as historical archives. You know, Bush publishes a memoir, you know, and try to figure out what he thinks, what was he thinking at a certain time. But the interesting part of the memoir is that often it is a compilation of memories. And it may be a compilation not simply by the people who are the subjects of the memoir, but they are often ghostwritten. They're often put together by all kinds of different groups of people, a group, a ghostwriter, somebody helped edit and write them. So these are interesting, one might say, memory projects. And for me, they're interesting because they tell you something about the way in which these people in the bureaucracy thought about their lives and thought about their role in the state, but also what they also tell you a little bit about what they thought about their own ideas of their masculinity, what they thought the state, the nation is about. But they also tell you a little bit about the people who help write them, who publish them. And the consumption of these and the publication of so many of these tells you something about the interest in the public in India about all these people. So I'm interested in all of these kinds of issues that emerge from seeing the memoir, not simply as a historical archive, but as a particular kind of genre that does some work. It's publication, people buy it, read it, what did they get out of it, why they put it together. So all of these are really interesting questions of the medium itself, the memoir as a genre, a particular kind of medium to present a life, a history. The topic that I'm gonna focus on is the memoirs of these bureaucrats. And these tell you a great deal about the bureaucracy in India after the British colonization ended. And my focus is on the memoirs of four people in this chapter who worked in the British colonial state, but after independence, after the British left, they continued on to become part of the Indian administrative service. So they moved from the ICS, the Indian Civil Service, under the British as it was called, to the Indian Administrative Service as it was called after independence. So let me talk about these. In an afterword to one of the memoirs that I mentioned here, and I'm going to talk about some of the aspects of four of these, in an afterword to H.M. Patel's memoir, the third one down here, his son-in-law, Percy Frederick, who was a poet as well as a pioneering advertising executive, think about that combination, reflects on Patel's life in the newly independent India in the following words. He says, "It struck me that the whole of upper class India was in fact a small village scattered geographically in Delhi, Bombay, and perhaps three or four other metropolitan cities. Everybody knows everybody else, or at least someone who knows anybody else who mattered. I was amazed at first, and later amused by the small, fragile ring of concentric circles, amounting perhaps to 10,000 families, who in point of fact were the real rulers of India. I very marked sense that 1947, the year that India became independent, may have ushered in a nominal democracy, but this nation remained, with anyone or anybody with eyes to see, a seamlessly functioning triple oligarchy of political power, industrial wealth, and media influence. So the triple oligarchy that is mentioned here included as one part the bureaucrats, such as H.M. Patel, who were part of this ruling group. He started out in the Indian civil service. He became one of those who worked later on in the Indian administrative service. He came under a cloud of scandal for a charge of corruption in an insurance scheme that was being set up by the Indian government. He left, tried to be a politician, and became a philanthropist, endowing schools and creating a network of educational institutions in his hometown. He was able to move from one realm of power to the other, and his wealth, status, his acquaintanceship, and access to high-level politicians helped him get to these positions. Cuthbert's remarks reveal the emerging also challenges to these powers. Cuthbert himself is saying, how can this be that 10,000 families rule what's called a democracy? How can it be an oligarchy and a democracy at the same time? But the awareness, my quotation of Cuthbert shows that this is a person who's showing awareness that there's something wrong with this kind of power. There's something happening in democracy which continues the power of these elite families. So Patel's memoir is one of four I examined. Many more have been published. But these texts provide evidence of the kinds of bureaucrats who became important figures in the newly independent state. Some were more prominent than others. Only one of these memoirs is published by the author during his lifetime, the first one. The other three were all published posthumously after the death, and they were by relatives, by friends. Buddhalingam's memoir, A Memoirs of the Civil Servant, is compiled by people who are part of what he created called the Buddhalingam Trust. He was a very major economist, and they wanted to continue his legacy of Keynesian economics into independent India. Right? And so they published his memoirs because I think it's important for people to see that this kind of economic theory needs to be important, even though the Indian government often didn't follow these theories, right? H.M. Patel's is published by his daughter, who became also a prominent member, who is also a prominent member of the Indian Administrative Service, and she and her other sister published this, asked one of the historians in Delhi, at Jawaharlal Nehru University, to help them edit his papers and to publish this, because they think it's important for people to see what he achieved. And since he left under a cloud of scandal, they're really interested in showing his side of things. Right? They're showing that he was actually a worthwhile person, even though he left under a cloud of scandal. Sri Nagesh's was published by his niece and the niece's husband, and they're also historians who are interested in publishing the story of this relatively unknown bureaucrat as well. And Narmavivari is sort of, he writes this as though he needs to share his wisdom with subsequent generations. So he writes it from this idea that he knows a lot about governance and must share this with people coming after him. So these are the sort of reasons behind the publication. That the British civil service was comprised of upper caste and mostly Hindu upper caste males is well known. Indian recruits came from upper tier professional occupations such as government service, medicine, law, and teaching. After only offering civil service exams in Britain, the ICS was opened up to Indians in 1922. But the exams were still given in Britain, so many people who could afford to go were able to take them. The numbers of Indians were kept low so as not to make Europeans and British people a minority in the service. By 1942, almost half of the service were Indians. And we know also that access to Western-type English education was a crucial factor in the formation of the civil service. So the civil service exam would include issues like testimonies to his character, all these sort of, as well as passing in the first class at Cambridge or University. A study of these bureaucrats reveals much about the formation of networks of male power and hegemonic masculinities that make up these patriarchies. While many scholars and prominent historians, such as Parker Chatterjee and others, have written about the nationalist elites whose characteristics were reason and rationality, or about how these elites were gendered, my research shows that such a elite is formed by an interconnected group of men. I want to pay attention to this oligarchy and what this oligarchy means in terms of this gender. Such masculinities, I argue, move from a more elite form of paternalistic and authoritarian governance style to a more technocratic masculinity that becomes normative among upper classes in India. So, and I also want to argue that the masculinity and the power of this group comes not simply from their work in the state, right? The rational, reasonable state and the rational, reasonable bureaucracy that Wendell writes about, but also from the power they accrued within the networks mentioned by Kutcher. How did this oligarchy remain powerful? And their ability to produce a kind of masculine patriarchy through the separation between public and private spheres. So thus elite masculinity is normative because it expanded and became powerful and normative. People yearn for it, people desire to occupy this kind of power. But the power, kind of power it was, kept changing. So I'm going to focus on four aspects of this. Right? Thinking about understanding bureaucracy through patriarchy and masculinity. Right? The discourses of corruption, the challenges to power, the intimacies of governance, which Ann Stoller has argued that what happens to ruling elites, and especially in her work on colonial elites, was not simply about what they did in the offices, but their relationships at home with their servants, with their families, with their other people they socialized with, all of them. So she argues that power is accrued as much through these social networks and private intimacies as it is in the public sphere as well. And the kind of idea is continuous power. Through generations. So, similar to the autobiography, the memoirs often begin with childhood, parents, and education, but the narrative predominantly concerns the making of the bureaucrat rather than the individual, because the focus is the job of being selected, the mastery within training in rural locations, and the detailing of accomplishments, promotions, interactions with politicians and famous people, ending with retirement and advice to subsequent generations. This is often very much the form of all, many of these memoirs. The apex of the career is the position in the highest echelons of government, in the center, in New Delhi, in the prime minister's office of some such, and this is considered the pinnacle of the career. When they begin with childhood, the memoirs narrate the early years as preliminary to the making of the bureaucrat. So these memoirs will contain photographs such as these, which are about the parents, the child, and the bureaucrat as child. Because the exams are taken in England, they require them to, at this earlier period of the 20th century, they require a first-class pass from the British universities. Many of these men go to England to study. And they study, and even the kind of hard life in Britain, for many of these very elite men, becomes the kind of preliminary to the making of bureaucrat. Srinagesh, for instance, was sent off as a child with his blood brother to boarding school and did not come back to India for 16 years. His memoir begins with birth in the proper fashion of a Victorian novel. I was born on 1st January 1905, and if my father had believed in horoscopes, I am sure the astrologers who have gone to town on the future that awaited me. The memoir then, from the first moment, produces his modernity. I believe in astrology, right? He has more scientific temperament, he argues, he implies. He makes a gender division between his mother, who insists who wants the horoscope, and his father, who doesn't, and he relates that debate in the story. He relates that the year of his birth was significant because it was the year of the Wright brothers' first strike, and important events in the history of the Russian Revolution and the Moroccan crisis. The observation becomes noteworthy by the subsequent account of managing India's first aircraft company after independence, right? And this sort of early indication, his narrative also gestures through his later life as well. You can see, because the memoir is written in later life, it's a sort of retrospective, it's an edited memory bank in some way. He sees his life as being from the start beyond the scope of his family. He appreciates the work of his father, back in India. He shows appreciation for his mother, who is supported by her husband to get a degree from Edinburgh, and also bears 7 children while being active in many organizations. But in the later part of the memoir, there's a hearty admiration of her and this tremendously accomplished woman. Yet the astonishing achievement of his mother does not get more than a cursory mention. Since maternal influences, he's sent to boarding school in England, and it's a single-sex, male-only boarding school with very few women, only the ones who serve as nurses and caretakers of the boarders in the school. So women are sort of banished from this kind of boarding school education, and many people have written about the impact of this kind of male-masculine context on the upbringing of many British elites at the time. At university, he follows his brother, becoming a prefect. He's an athlete. He excels in sporting activities. He continues in university with a sporting life. And he shows, and he believes that this, as even though he is from India and he is considered racially very different and looked down upon, he feels he gets the respect of other people because of his athletic ability. All through the narrative, he shows his awareness of what he calls the color bar. You have resonances of American, US kind of articulations of race. Mentioning that his brother in the elite military academy centers encounters, he says, a color situation that was far worse from what he did. He mentions how such racism at Cambridge affected him, since he says he was one of the niggers. The students from India and the colony, he designates himself as that. He mentions few friends by name. His closest relationship remains only with his brother, though at some points there's also competition with him, especially with regard to women. He narrates how a girl he brings home at college seems to prefer his brother, right? And acknowledging that the girl likes his brother, he leaves them together. This is the first sense of his complex relationship with English women. And on his return to India after university, he remarks that English women who had been friends with in England would not associate with Indians on the ships coming to India from Britain. Because, he says, they were so bent on finding, their job was to find English husbands. He calls them the fishing fleet. Echoing masculine derision, but an anger, a kind of racialized anger at the racism he encounters. In some ways, his single-sex boarding school experience, his rejection by English women, and his claim that emerges later that he is against, he says, mixed marriages. He doesn't like interracial marriages, he says. Such comments are also reminders of the exclusions of the memoir. He includes photographs of his parents in this kind of image, but he says, and at some point, his sister and mother come to stay with him. But he seldom mentions the work that he's doing in the household, the work that continues, supports his job as administrator. Right? In that sense, he's different even from the tale. So, who also mentions his father, who also, and his mother. So, the genre form has to mention the upbringing. But this is Srinagesh in Cambridge. You can see his kind of masculine, the life of a life lived among men continues on to Cambridge. And subsequently, I'll show you another picture later. This is the tale. And the tale memoir is interesting because it includes images of his daughters and his wife as well. But we have to remember that who compiles the images? It's the daughter who compiles the images. So we have some sense that there might be an interest in adding some of these photographs as well to the published memoir because of who published it. So Patel's also begins with these sort of memories of his early years in Britain, his upbringing, his difficulties in living in England, right? And he includes photographs, and his memoir includes these images of his wife. Bootha Lingam's memoir begins with a similar trajectory showing his childhood as indicative of his later prominence. He says, I think I was subsequently aware that I would do something with my life by the time I was 12. I was quite developed mentally. I had read a lot, a great deal for my age, and very widely too, he says. He writes of his education at Cambridge, his studies with John Henry Keynes, and the lessons he learned, he says, were useful to him. He's less interested in sort of, his memoir has not even a mention of his wife or children at all, none of them. And that's interesting to suggest the kind of division that these memoirs are making between what they see as a bureaucracy and its public face and the private life of the bureaucrats, right? They leave that out. A more authoritarian sort of patriarchy is visible in Ramaviras, in his authority that enables him, he says, to govern, he says. Thus, he said, when he becomes governor in India as well, he moves from being in the civil service to being appointed as governor of a couple of states, and he says, he tells you what he thinks of his philosophy of governance. He says, the head and the states are all members of the joint family. We cannot expect that there will be uniformity in the thoughts and actions of each member of the family. There may be differences of approach and even disagreements, but when, in the interest of the continuance of the family as an entity, the father or the oldest member counsels a particular course of action, this advice has to be followed. So what he believes is that the wisdom of himself as the head of his family, a larger extended network of kin, continues on to his wisdom in governance as well. The notion of a similar kind of power pervades the idea of the state as well. The state and the family are one, and we see this kind of analogy being made many, many different people. In newly independent India, the decision to continue the civil service in the same form as in colonial India produced a complex relation to the colonial state and to the new state. In these memoirs, these bureaucrats profess loyalty to Indian nationalism and to the new nation, but they have to distinguish themselves, they have to separate themselves from the colonial state itself, and this is an important project for them, to show that they're loyal to the new nation, but that their loyalty to the new nation and the benefits to the new nation comes from how good they were as bureaucrats in the colonial state. So they have to kind of ride this fine line between showing loyalty and goodwill to the very exploitative colonial state, but also show how necessary they are to the new state as well. The representation of themselves and their abilities comes as much from their past in the colonial administration as from the service to the new nation. Yet, this kind of loyalty is also brings about challenges from lots of people as well. For instance, Jawaharlal Nehru, who was the first Prime Minister of India, did not want any of these people to be part of the post-colonial state. Nehru thought they were a luxury, they were part of the colonial apparatus. And Srinagesh, who works with Nehru, just cannot comprehend why Nehru would feel that way. And he thinks he's figured it out. He writes several times in his memoir that because Nehru did not get a first class at Cambridge and couldn't get into the civil service, that he hated the colonial civil service. So he hated all these guys who did get into the colonial civil service. Right? But conflicts with Nehru and later with Nehru's Congress Party, but he sees his own work as necessary to the new nation as well. And he says that his close connections and his connections with other bureaucrats allows the new Indian state to come into existence. The history of close relations with British creates much distrust also towards the bureaucrats. And though their power and status continues unabated, and it's also that power is a locus of a lot of jealousy, challenges, charges of corruption that emerge very soon after the colonial state is created. Never quite disavowing colonial power, these bureaucrats' memoirs articulate the new civil service as a precarious continuation of the colonial steel frame, as it was called, that kept the empire going. It remains a living concept, right, for all these guys. In particular, the link between the careers and the formation of the nation suggests both the masculinism of the state of the nation and the continued claim of power of these elites. Patel recounts the importance of his work. His work after partition is to divide up the assets of India, decide what goes where, who gets what in Pakistan and India. Srinagesh claims that the ICS, the old civil service, enabled the new administration of India, right? And he says it was the old civil service with the mainstay of the new India. He regrets that Nehru calls it a cut services or an expensive luxury. It's a feminization that he finds offensive. Bureaucratic masculinity becomes a normative through the links to the colonial state, but its ability to suture itself to an emerging modern and technocratic elite. New intimacies and connections are forged. Srinagesh presents the frustrations of taking over new arenas of work, establishing steel plants, airplane factories in the new India, right, and his ability to manage these. Buddhalingam mentions technology-seeking trips to the US and Europe that bring him into contact with all kinds of different sets of elites as well, and elites in these countries, and his struggles to create agreements with new states. In particular, three areas of work mentioned in the memoir become significant for the making of new kinds of what I call technocratic masculinities. Technologies of manufacturing, industrialization, expertise in finance and management as specific, and management as specific areas. So finance, technology, and management as new areas of knowledge and to which these old ICS attach themselves as experts, and they argue that they can be experts because they are able governors, they are able managers. For instance, Bhutalinga's narrative exemplifies this new areas of expertise and linking to networks of power. In the British service, he worked in the Department of Supplies in the Director General of Munitions Production during the Second World War. He narrates that his experience is what leads Nehru after independence to give him the charge of creating new steel plants. He says, I can say, he says, that my main achievement was the construction of three new steel plants in the public sector. Because of the targets set for these plants, he tells us that the task required Herculean effort, and he could do this because he was, quote, a disciplined civil servant. On a chapter in the memoir on Nehru's industrial policy, he writes of the contradictions of the Indian state, trying to combine Nehruvian industrialization with Gandhian ideas of cottage industries. Okay? And the next step in his career becomes the finance ministry. His account of his work ends with a great deal of self-congratulation. It is in such ways that I completely changed the character of the Department of Expenditure. To this day, both my contemporaries and many younger people vividly remember this. I made it a live ministry by introducing new concepts. Srinagesh develops management as a new area of expertise, and he becomes very active in the new emerging Indian Institute of Management, the centers of management, as a new form of expertise. So, but it's these very issues that are really important to think about in relation to the question of masculinity. And I want to not stick just with masculinity, but think about the kind of oligarchy that I mentioned earlier. How do you relate these masculinities to that oligarchy of power? one can see how the production of the state becomes this sort of enterprise of separating, creating a notion of what is public and how to separate it from the private. Thus, it's not just the women and the families that are excluded from the memoirs, but all those who are below them in the bureaucracy, right? The memoirs always narrate upward in the social and political hierarchy, listing traffic with famous figures, promotions gained and lost, their encounters with Nehru and other kind of famous figures. They hope to maintain power, even as those who see themselves as part of the state challenge them. But generally, few the obligations of family life in which the bureaucrat's life is made possible by many people working below them. Lower level clerks, drivers, subordinates, peons, wives, children, all these kinds of things. There is no mention of the lives of those who enable the work of the great men. The intimacies of the separate private domain are erased or are left out very much. Kinship looks upward to those with more power. Some important figures are mentioned, but also other bureaucrats as well. These memoirs insist on these place of these patriarchal networks long after they have retired or have passed away. Their post-colonial specificity comes from such a desire to go clean and disavow these colonial legacies, even as in later decades it's under attack by those accused of elitism and corruption. If Anne Stover's focus on the intimacies of colonial rule suggests the domestic arrangement provide important insights into colonial governance, the erasure of domestic intimacies and the focus on relations with superiors and powerful men that are visible in the memoir or that are included, deliberately included only in the memoir, suggest that these intimacies are not just about a private sphere, right? Rather, they are about separating and producing a separate public and private sphere while retaining the advantages of the connections across them, right? Such separations and relations become critical for the formations of masculinity and the networks of patriarchy that endow them with power and privilege. And I'm going to show you just in closing a few more. This is the tale of his family. Another one. This is one of those who extreme against the he was a manager of aircraft factory. This is the Chinese premier, picture short and live, included here. Another important figure, Haile Selassie, at the center visiting India, he's included in there. Another aircraft image included in Srinagesh's memoir. This is Patel as defense secretary, showing his sort of machines and the upcoming Indian, showing life. Mary. The swearing and ceremony of the first cabinet of independent India. Patel is to the left. These are the few images of Patel with his valet. And with his wife and children. And this is Srinagesh with a couple of his people who work for him. And this is the district office staff for Srinagesh as well. So you can see it continues a couple of things. These photographs are really interesting because they show you the ways in which hierarchies are photographed, right? You're so used to seeing classroom class photographs, for all these groups, but they're really important archives of information about how power and masculinity come in. And I'll stop here.
What's your favorite memoir and why?
was my favorite. I think in this, there are many others that I look at in the book. I'm going, this is one chapter of the book. In another chapter of the book, I look at those bureaucrats who started their work after independence, so they're very different. In this group, I like Srinagesh's memoir more because it's more interesting in terms of what comes through in his complicated relationships with all kinds of different people. So, and sort of reading carefully to the memoir, you see little glimpses of these other people, and because they are there, I find this more interesting. But there are many things that are extremely disturbing about all of these memoirs and the way they exercise power, and I can talk about that. So for Srinagesh, for instance, he is one of those who is in charge in Punjab during partition, right? So when there's horrendous sort of violence that is going on as people are moving back and forth, well, not back and forth, are moving across the boundaries, right? Lots of Hindus and Sikhs are coming into what becomes India. A great deal of the Muslim population of North India, mostly in Punjab, moves to Pakistan. There's a great deal of violence. And his sort of very attenuated description of the violence is really disturbing to me, right? And so the way that he upholds this idea of a rational bureaucrat who is very objectively looking at the violence and seeing what can be done is really interesting. But there was a hand in the back there. I'm going to take it.
Are these memoirs read by a lot of the Indian people and therefore, you know, kind of furthering that sense of patriarchal society?
Well, they're published by some really important presses in India. So what I can say is that judging by the numbers of these that are published and by the fact that they're published by somewhat important presses and the ways in which they are cited by historians, I can see that people are reading them. Ooh, now I haven't kept track of who. Maybe I'll start from there, yes. Females to gain more political power. So one part of this book is going to be on the women bureaucrats as well. So from the first moment of independence, as this new civil service is being created, there are challenges from women who are active in the independence movement and who actively participate in creating the new India as to what is going to be done about when are women going to be bureaucrats too. So there are challenges to the male-only normative idea of the bureaucrats. So they challenge them, and over time, there are women who do enter. Now there are a lot of women who are part of this bureaucracy. But for a long time, the work that women bureaucrats did and the male bureaucrats did was very different. So for instance, women were not, so all, in this civil service, everyone is posted to rural areas for their first years of the service, except for the women, because it was considered at one point to be dangerous for them to be sent to a remote rural part of India on their own. So because they don't do that kind of step that is normal for the bureaucrat, they don't even reach the top echelons of the bureaucracy. So they are sort of the discrimination against them, but that has changed now. So many of them could only go to rural areas if they were married to I.A.S. Their husband was also a bureaucrat. Yes.
Are women and lesser bureaucrats omitted from their memoirs because they're not viewed as important to their success?
Well, there aren't that many memoirs of the women. This is the interesting thing. Though you find accounts of them in different ways. So in understanding there are very, very few memoirs that I've been able to find, and some of them are not in this elite civil service, but they're in other kind of civil services in India as well. So it's been kind of hard for me to find the numbers of memoirs by women as that I find of the men. So there's some discrepancy. Other kind of here.
How would you say the bureaucracy is different now that women are more involved? I don't know if it's
How is it the difference? Well, in some ways, the entire bureaucracy has changed over time. Not only are there women in the bureaucracy, but there are also people who in previous years were not considered, who weren't elite enough to be part of it. So people from Dalits, the different sort of castes who were not considered high castes, they weren't part of it, but now there have been sort of affirmative action type programs to enable them, that there are quotas and programs to enable them to enter the bureaucracy. So the presence of women, of Dalits, of people from all kinds of regions have changed the nature of bureaucracy. But it's still quite elite, so that whoever gets into it accrues a great deal of power, and they've also exercised that power in some similar ways that I am describing. But the kinds of way they exercise their power, the way they talk about themselves, their accounts of women are interesting. Because sometimes you hear these accounts where, when there are scandals, so there are sex scandals, a woman bureaucrat is assaulted, for instance, or she cannot be promoted. So the obstacles and the problems show you the presence that they're in the service, but also show you the difficulties that continue to face in the service in terms of discrimination against them, attitudes towards them, even as they have reached the highest echelons of the civil service. Yes.
Based on your research, what kind of policies would you like to see implemented in modern India today to deal with some of these issues like underrepresentation within the civil service?
I don't know that I have the expertise to say what kinds of policies they should have. I never think about formulating policies. All I can say is all I think about is thinking about how the inclusion of different groups of women or different groups of men changes the nature of the bureaucracy, perhaps. But I don't know how you can. Okay. The reason why I don't do that is because these guys all try to do this. So they try to say, well, I know best how you can change the bureaucracy to be better or cleaned up or whatever else, right? And I think that bureaucracy is a space in which certain kind of power gets exercised, right? And civil society's job is to make them do some things, right?
Yes. And remember that you read, have you read any cases where males are challenged or resisted these masculine systems of bureaucracy?
Well, what's interesting is that they challenge them because they're very aware that the general public views them as being elite, corrupt, incompetent. They're universally disliked by all kinds of people. So I've read some of the surveys of general people's attitudes towards the civil service, and it is horrendous reading. They should be embarrassed. So they're quite aware that they are very much disliked and that they're charged with corruption. But I'm not sure whether any of, and there are many people in the bureaucracy who's extremely interesting, smart people, but the way in which power works is not simply because a certain individual is a certain way, but power works because coming into the bureaucracy endows them with a certain kind of power, right? But it also takes away their ability to do certain things that they might want to, just because of the structure of what you can and cannot do within the bureaucracy. Yes? Lucia, yeah?
Does religion play a role in entering the bureaucracy?
Yeah, really good question. Okay, so in these fields, have one of the things we see very much in Padeo, for instance, is very, when he works during partition, he thinks of himself as working for an India that does not have Muslims. At some points, he refers to Muslims as all being in Pakistan, which is interesting because India has the second largest Muslim population in the world. I think that's what they did. But so to at that moment of independence, to work in this situation, and just because some of his Muslim colleagues in the British civil service moved to Pakistan to become participants in the civil service there, he sort of conceptualizes his kind of concept of India is of a very Hindu India. So in that sense, I would say that there are ideas of religion and what the relationship to the nation that are sort of stark at a long time ago as well. So they're there in some kind of way. And the other way in which it enters is because many of the people who, among Hindus who become part of the IS in these years that I am describing, in the first part of the 20th century, are also very high caste Hindu. They are caste Hindus as well. But they're also elite Muslims, they're elite Sikhs, there are other elites also who are politics as well. And one other way in which that's really interesting is that the way they continue their power is they try to organize marriages for their children within this bureaucracy as well. So for instance, when people are selected for the civil service, they try to get their sons and daughters to meet them. So there's sort of a kind of organization of networks and proper marriage partners that emerge for each of those that are segregated by religion, caste, etc. So the new democracy is very conscious of religious differences, of caste differences, of classes. Yes?
You mentioned how their childhood shaped their views and perspective in the schools, but can you explain or mention how culture shaped their views and actions?
One of the ways in which the memoirs are compiled is they're compiled by papers that these people use, right? And some are written by these guys. So just imagine them, if being compiled on the one hand by people who are family members or people who are interested in their memories, but also by these guys themselves. So it's hard to say that the childhood shaped their worldview. What I will say is that they're at the moment that they write their memoir, they shape their childhood, right? So the writing and how what is written and what they can see and the photographs they have, all of these are ways in which they produce a narrative of their childhood. So, you know, memory is an interesting thing to think about how you write your past. So, and culture is a difficult thing. I don't know what culture is, how much we, I mean, there's an anthropological notion of culture, and there's a high culture notion of culture, right? High culture movement. So these guys become powerful because they know high culture, by which I mean they study English education, they know the British classics, they know the canons of Western literature, they know all of these because they study them in British universities. And this is at this particular period of time, the early part of the 20th century. Now, of course, it's totally different what people study for. There are different exams, there are different areas of testing, all kinds of things. Yes?
How are women generally treated in Indian society?
Well, they're treated kind of like they are in American society. Some are honored, some are treated badly, some are. One of the ways in which I've tried to think about this really, really important question is to understand why we think some societies are worse than others, right? And when I look, for instance, these ideas of other cultures are produced. So there's a very wonderful book that just came out by an anthropologist called Lila Abu-Lugo that says, what is it? Do Muslim women still need saving, right? That's it? Still need saving, is that what it's called? And it's really wonderful because it talks about her kind of, her work among this particular community in Egypt. And she talks about how she thinks those women are not uniformly victims of their culture, right? That they're complex human beings who have complex relationships to their society. So if you look at it, for instance, when I look at the US, it's hard for me, for instance, to look at some of the ways in which people respond on the internet, the polling that goes on, to think that this society isn't patriarchal, right? And what would be interesting is to see when Hillary Clinton runs for office, what happens. This we shall see. Yes?
So I live in a problem in the Middle East, but what people didn't know is that, like, I heard there was a high prevalence of, like, honor killings and forced marriages and rape in India.
Well, the stats on those here are awful, too. Okay? So the way that I understood this, and in Lila Abu-Lugo's book, she has a chapter on honor killings and understanding how to understand books. So the idea of honor is an interesting concept. Right? It's been a very much part of understanding, in anthropology, for instance, honor societies. Right? What was honor? How did honor shape masculinity and ideas of family and what people did? And so the kind of emergence of modernity and modern Western societies has meant that some societies are not seen or understood or see themselves as having been honor societies or ruled by honor. But the question about how we define honor, what honor is, what is an honor killing, is a really debatable and interesting matter. So the way that it's used in media, for instance, over the last 10 years in India, is at the one level, because I did a study of media circulations of the term honor killings. So one of the ways in which the Indian media in the early part of this last decade talked about honor killings as though something that happened in Muslim societies and in Pakistan. Over the years, they shifted to talk, well, it happens in India too. Now, much of the discourse of honor killings is about rural communities and what happens in rural India. So the way that the media coverage and the idea of honor killings is to say that we, people in the metropolitan, people writing the newspapers, the editors, the reporters, we don't do this kind of violence. Those people over there use that kind of violence. And the kind of circulation of this idea that there are those bad people in rural India, in Pakistan, in the Middle East who do this, creates a sense of their own superiority as well. So, and also in India, when police can say something, oh, this is an honor killing, they don't have to investigate too much. They can quickly find, you know, what is an honor killing. So more and more it's used by very incompetent police force. Yes?
So you mentioned earlier
so the triple oligarchy is the elite bureaucrats, the industrialists, and the politicians, right? These three. And the relations between these three have always been the source of much of the charges of corruption that we see to this day in India as well. So there's great suspicion about, people are generally quite suspicious about the relationships across these three domains. It's become very important for a lot of politicians to say that they are against corruption and they're going to root out corruption, but their very power comes from the relationships across these two domains. Yes?
If you were the person compiling this picture, so what kind of picture would you have had to, like, more
if I had, I didn't
know. What kind of pictures we had included if you were the person like compiling this memoir?
the photographs, incorporating them to think about where they fit into the history of photography in India, from the emergence of colonial photography, the images of the white man with his foot on the dead tiger that he had shot, to this kind of photograph, to the emergence of, you know, studio photography, families recording themselves. So there's a really interesting history of photography to be learned, and this is a small part of our history.
What's a woman's, women's
rate? Women's rate
in professional fields?
What is the employment rate?
Like,
no, come on.
You said, like,
I don't know how many, what percentage are women at the present time. Is that what you're asking? There is some, there are caste-based programs, there are more and more groups included in those seats that are kept for a particular group. And it's important to keep those seats because sort of historical discrimination in a way has to be addressed. You can't have just these high caste people continuing this. Yes.
Hi. I was just wondering if with more women in politics in India, have the memoirs of recent politicians shifted in their nature of excluding subordinates or?
Yeah. I have to tell you, I haven't read the politician's memoir, so I can't say much about this. I've just been reading these bureaucrats. Mm-hmm. Are they the new ones? Maya might be asking? No, I don't think so. Well, we'll wait and see.
Okay.
I don't know. Yes.
What do you think of Indira Gandhi was the Prime Minister of India?
In what way?
Like, in reference to this patriarchal sort of
society. Right, right. She's really interesting because she was the daughter of the first Prime Minister, right? She's also come from a very elite family. She had many, many benefits of elite education. She comes from a high caste group, right? The Nehru's came from that. So she had great advantages. Many women politicians in different parts of the world gain their power from association with other male politicians. And this is changing in some ways, but not in the the ways in which their associations with other powerful people are important to them is there. But we can also say for the male children or the male associates of famous politicians also benefit from these. Okay? So legacies are really important for lots of people. Yes?
You had mentioned that women and children weren't included in the memoirs. Is there just like a general assumption that they weren't included because they didn't contribute to their career or that they just weren't important?
All of the above. I mean, part of it is the memoir is not an autobiography, right? The memoir is a memoir of the bureaucrat, right? And they perceive these topics as being outside the framework of the work or the understanding of what a bureaucrat does. Right?
So they just didn't have any.
So for them to include all of these stories, I mentioned would be difficult. One or two of them that I've read tell you about their youth and what they did with their friends when they were in college and things like that, or in the earlier years of being real friends. Some of the ways in which one can think about these are from the novels. There are novels as well, and there are some famous novels of bureaucrats in India, this particular civil service, that are really interesting. Yes?
Thank you. I was wondering, do you think because of the focus that they have in their memoirs on more powerful males that they run into rather than their family or intimate relationships, that they make decisions and use their power to support or create a system that more supports male hierarchy compared to family relationships? And then do you think the family relationship structure itself is
kind of skewed in society such that it doesn't give women much of a chance to get into the public sphere?
Well, part of what I'm questioning is, like many feminist scholars, I question the demarcation of public and private, right? So what I'm trying to do is question why we make these kinds of, why these demarcations make sense, right? For whom do they make sense, right? And so I'm questioning the ways in which you create the space called the public and you create this space called the private and you say that these are separate from each other. So I'm questioning the logic of separating when I see, like many scholars see them as completely intertwined as well. So I'm trying to question the very logic of these and not set aside family relations as having nothing to do with power or with governance or with corruption. So, for instance, most accounts in social sciences of corruption look at what's called the public sphere, the marketplace, and things like that. So I'm interested in seeing how kind of access to women, as Wendy Brown calls them, how the relationships and the power that you accrue within the family and its networks are also part of the benefits of corruption that other people charge, that make other people upset, that make them concerned. So the very things that show the kind of corrupt bureaucrats, the massive house that a bureaucrat may have, that couldn't exist if that person lived simply on their salary, right, is the ways in which people will say, for instance, how does this person have this big house? How does this person have this? How did, and in India, for instance, one of the popular ways of talking about corruption is to gesture to how the weddings, how extravagant were the wedding, for instance. So how do we think of these domains of separating public and private, right? The wedding becomes a place where this person will showcase their wealth, right? An extravagant party. But it's the very awareness of this wedding and its public nature. People can see it, you saw it on the street, you know, you can see it, which will lead to the charges of corruption. Yes?
And given that you stated there's such like a prominent masculine identity in civil service, would you say there's a strong feminist movement in India to counter that male-dominated field?
So when I'm looking at the kind of the early part of the years, the first pretty much, I'm looking at a period from early part of the 20th century, from like 1930s to about 1975, at least that. Right? So I'm not talking about subsequent years after that. So I'm looking at that. So what was the second part of your question?
I was just referencing that you said that though women are still in the they're growing into the civil service now, it's not equal to that of men. And if
right.
And if because there's still that disparity, if there's a strong movement to counter that from a feminist perspective.
Oh, the feminist. Yes. There are many strong feminist movements, but many of the feminist movements in India have concern themselves with the bureaucracy to charge it with corruption, but also to charge that these bureaucrats care nothing for the lives of the poor women. So they've been very critical in terms of questioning women as predominantly poor, for instance, a large number of women in rural India are very poor, don't have property, don't have access. So what they say, what the feminist movement has said is to charge the bureaucracy with not caring or being corrupt and taking eating up the development money, not giving what these women require, et cetera, et cetera. So their work has been to pay more attention to issues of poverty, discrimination. They paid attention to questions of law, addressing rape, laws of rape, a whole bunch of other kinds of laws. And they have not concerned, they've been concerned with sort of affirmative action kind of policies, but it's not something that the feminist movement has taken on as a huge part of their work. They're more concerned with this inequality, impoverishment, all of these issues.
What do you think a memoir does better bad person as opposed to a very good body. And then also, what does it omit? Yeah.
Well, the memoir depends on, all of these are projects of memory. There are some scholars call them all life narratives, right? They're all creating life. They're doing them in different ways. An autobiography has a particular kind of form that we recognize as an autobiography. It's more personal. It's written by the person itself, the person who's the subject of it. It's a particular kind of genre. The memoir is another kind of genre. But the memoir has different subgenres, right? And they all have particular characteristics that show that they are a memoir, or they're an autobiography, or they're a biography. So they are all different kinds of genres, and they produce different accounts of people, right? And within them, there are many subgenres. So a memoir can be, you know, now a memoir can be written by, you know, 16-year-old Malala Yousafzai, who writes about her experience as a memoir. So a memoir can be written, you know, not somebody who's finished their career at work, but it can be written by anybody. So that's a really interesting popular genre. That was a hand there, and then I'll come back.
How do male bureaucrats view women who become involved in the
process? What's that again?
Well, they are, because of the numbers have increased thus far, their attitudes towards them are much different than they used to be. Okay? But there are cases in which you can still see that they are treated differently, as having different trajectories, as being more concerned with family, raising family. But every now and then you will hear of a bureaucrat who's amazingly powerful. Right? And there are many, many very powerful women bureaucrats now in India as well. And some of them are charged with corruption as much as other male bureaucrats as well. So, but the nature of the way in which they're charged with corruption, the way their life accounts are written, maybe somewhat.
From the formal bureaucratic milk, if you have the chance or the opportunity to interview or have a conversation with, who would it be?
Oh, if I would talk to them?
Mm-hmm.
Any one of them. They're so interesting. Right? They're all very interesting. And I've talked to lots of bureaucrats who are my contemporaries, right? Who I know, who I've come across, and they're all, one of them is a colleague of mine. You know, he's an anthropologist now, but he used to be a bureaucrat. So there are all kinds of bureaucrats, and they're all really, for me, they're all really interesting because I can ask them about the nature of the bureaucracy now and how they experienced it and what they felt was. But I also have to think critically about the enterprise itself.
I have one last question.
Yes. How did you
first get involved with
this study? Oh, I got involved with it because I was looking at the case of a woman bureaucrat who I heard of from my hometown, who had accused a very powerful police officer of sexual harassment. So this became a very, really important case in India. She took it to the court, she charged him sexual harassment, and she won the case after 10 years. So I became interested in the case, but then I became interested in the lives of the women who were harassed. And you have any?
What began my interest?
Responded to that. But I'm very interested in continuing